I've seen so many things changing in front of me. You know, all kinds of new things come up. You know, this thing also is a new thing, which I was told I should use because I should be able to hear it properly.
Yes,
I don't know whether I'm putting them properly or not, but I can hear you. That means it's okay.
it's good. It's good.
So I have some young friends. You know, one chap is a whisket, so he can always solve my problem.
Yes, we need now young people around us. Even my generation needs them.
Actually, I do use computer a lot, and I also design on computer. Yeah, now is it time?
I think we
Yes,
can
shall
start.
we?
Yes.
Mayhem? It's around 75 people have joined so far.
Yes, I think Pritham, you can. Yes.
Okay. So good afternoon to all of you. This is Pritam Dey from Assistant Professor at School of Architecture, Anand National University. And it gives me an immense pleasure to welcome you all at our month's lecture series 2021. In collaboration with Wadia College of Architecture, Mysore. So welcome you all too. As part of this lecture series, we had speakers from various creative disciplines to share their creative perspectives and their inspiration behind it. Today, we are extremely privileged to have with us the esteemed Padma Bhushan Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh sir, who is not only an artist, but an author, poet, critic, and who will be talking about places, people, and paintings. Professor Sharmila will be formally introducing Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh sir. We will have the lecture followed by a question and answer round. So people the students and the teachers and whoever esteemed guest is there, you can write down your questions while the webinar is on. After this whole talk, we'll be unmuting you all, and then probably you can speak and raise these questions to Sam. So having said that, again, a warm welcome to you all, and over to you, Professor Sharmila.
Thank you, Pritam. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh today, an internationally renowned writer, critic, and artist celebrated for his lush, richly narrative paintings. Padma Bhushan Sri Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh, fondly known as Sheikh Bhai to us, has been a key figure in Indian contemporary art since the early 1960s. He began his career rebelliously, forming Group 1890 in 1963 with 11 other emerging artists. They all were opposed to what they viewed as the stale and derivative art of the preceding generation. Turning towards his own country's cultural traditions, Sheikh Bhai draws inspiration from Persian, Mughal, and Pahari miniatures, Bhakti and Sufi poetry, and magical realism. This combined with his interest in European Renaissance, his art has shaped his approach to painting as a form of storytelling. Sheikh Bhai's canvases are populated with historical and fantastical figures, narrative vignettes, and intricate maps of the cosmos. They illustrate his own memories, historical and mythological scenes, and ultimately the universal experience of being human. His collection of Gujarati surrealist poems, Atva, published in 1974, won him critical acclaim. He has also written a prose series, Gher Jata, and edited a special issue of Kshitij. Sir, you have been an inspiration to my generation as an artist and as a teacher. I warmly welcome you to give us an insight about your creative journey. Thank you.
Sharmila just said something about storytelling. All paintings have stories to tell. Please show the first image. Stories come in different forms. Sometimes the stories are about people. Sometimes the stories relate to places. Sometimes stories relate to literally the whole world. I have this image in front of me, which is roughly entitled Vignapti Patra. Vignapti Patra means a kind of a letter of announcement. This letter of announcement is about the journey of a monk. We know that Jain monks usually walk. They walk from place to place. Wherever they are supposed to reach. And often, in this case, a letter of announcement is sent about the journey of this monk. For instance, there is this scroll painting, scroll as you understand, which is unfolded. It unfolds in time. You cannot have a full view of the scroll because the scroll is roughly 1 foot wide, but it can be 30, 40 feet long. So you have to unroll it and gradually see as the images appear one by one. Now in this case, it is the Vignapti Patra, which is called the Vignapti Patra of Jaisalmer, the medieval town of Rajasthan. And suppose the monk is leaving Rajasthan, that is Jaisalmer, and going to a place in Gujarat called Patan. The entire journey of the monk, so to say, is illustrated, painted in visuals in a scroll like this. So what is interesting about this scroll is that at one level you open it in time because you cannot gauge it in a single point of view. You have to keep on opening and there would be multiple images. Or in a way, the places that the monk would be visiting, beginning from Jaisalmer, and there would be the markets, there would be the places, perhaps temples, there would be people gathered around, there would be some kind of a fair or a festival, etc., etc. What is interesting is that this is related to a monk who walks. And in a way, the scroll appropriates his journey as though through his feet. And we may ask this question, what has human feet to do with painting? Next, please. If you were to go to Rajasthan, there are about dozen or more small towns near the city of Jaipur in a region called Shekhawati, where there are paintings all over buildings, all over mansions. Not only on the outer walls, as you can see here, but also inside the mansion, on the door, on the ceiling, on all walls of the building. One would think that a child born in a house like that would see painting next to mother. it would be something like a city of painting, a Chitra Nagari of sort. But how do you look at this painting? You have to walk. So the painting is connected with your walk. Painting in that sense is connected with your feet. So you don't see only with your eyes, not eyes alone. You see it with whole body, because if paintings are on both sides of the street, you have to walk up the street, then you have to walk down the street. And as you walk, as your feet would discover the street, your eyes would discover these images, which are almost life-size. An elephant is a life-size elephant, a horse is a life-size horse. And then there are stories. Now there is the story of an outlaw, and there are those who are running after. So you have even stories right in the middle of the street to read. Next, please. But that was actually your feet covering the street and literally watching as the stories unfold on the walls of a street. But here is a sort of a map. It is of a haveli of Nathadwara. Nathadwara is the center of Vaishnava shrine, Vaishnava idol called Srinathji. And you can see image of Srinathji at the top, somewhere inside. There are houses, there are streets. So in a way, the map allows you to walk into. Here you don't actually use your feet, but allow your mind's eye to wander from place to place, as you can enter from the bottom on the left, where there are two elephants are painted, and you enter the house. You go inside and you find cows painted. You go inside and there are many more mansions and mansions after mansions after mansions. And that the whole complex is called a haveli. So in that sense, the painting again unfolds in a different way in time. Next, please. In the cave paintings of Ajanta, you have stories of the previous lives of Lord Buddha. They're called Jataka stories, Jataka tales. Here is the story of King Mahajanak, who is seated in his harem with his queens. But as you can see, next, that Mahajanak then moves. He is on a horseback, and then he is in the street. So the story on the same wall where you saw Mahajanak inside his palace is now riding out. So you have to walk, and you walk alongside the story. Sometimes the story tells you to stop. Sometimes the story tells you to go further. So in a way, story guides you. Or in a way, one would even say, story controls you. And you enter into this story as you look. And you find that paintings are all around. If you've been to Ajanta, you would know that all walls are painted and all walls have paintings of stories of Jatakas. So in a way, you are surrounded by not only stories, but surrounded by people who are in the paintings. And you find yourself in the middle of that crowd, as though there are people all around you, and you are wading through the crowd. Next, please. There was this big scroll about 8 foot wide and about 15 foot high, painted for the Maharao of the kingdom of Kota in Rajasthan. Now Maharao, particularly Raja Ram Singh, second of the middle of 19th century, had actually made a journey. He actually went from Kota to Delhi. So the painting literally illustrates this, that the king on horseback with his retinue is moving upwards and goes from place to place. But at the same time, the painting opens out to the viewer, literally opening a vista, a vast scene alongside the journey of the Maharao, who then reaches the Fort of Delhi, as you can see the red fort there. Now, in a way, painting takes you along. The images in paintings indicate that you must also walk. If you walk, whether with your own feet, as in Rekhavati, but in a painting with your mind's eye, let your entire body move along with the images within the picture and take the journey that the Maharao is taking in this particular painting. I'll take you somewhere else. Next. This is the city of Siena in Italy. Siena, as you can make out from the scene on the left, has this vast ground, which is shown on the right again, which is a tower or a campanile. And all the streets which are sprouting from this so-called square, it's not actually square, it's like a shell. Its shape is like a shell. And it has got this little, as you can make out, these areas, you know, which are in a kind of a triangular format. And if you were to go to the street, you'll find that since Siena is built on hills, all streets are up the hill or down the hill. So you have to walk up or walk down. What is interesting, when I first saw this thing and I wrote this, the city is built on hills, lanes radiating from piazza. Piazza means that square. Each widen and close in intervals, like the movements of people using them. The experience of the uphill route of streets corresponds to rising breath, released as one reaches small open squares on the way, while return downhill is quick and sudden for an ecstatic gasp at the wondrous sight of the shell-like great piazza, large as a lake and touched by the shadowy arm of the campanile of the Palazzo Pubblico. So as you can see, architecture is related to a human body. In fact, with human walk and human breath. So in that sense, if you come to painting, next please. There is this great painting called Effects of Good Government. Actually, the painting is much larger than what I'm showing you. And it's in two parts, the effects of good and bad government. What I'm showing you is the area which displays, so to say, effects of good government, where people are in the street and there are all the buildings around. Now the painting would be at least about 15 to 20 foot wide. And obviously, if there is no space to go back, you have to walk the painting. You have to walk by the painting and gradually discover at the beginning of the balcony, then the big black structure, then the red structure, then there are horsemen going in another structure with the red bricks. Then you can see people building a structure. Then you move forward. And at the bottom, you can see people, some women dancing. There is a man with a donkey. And that goes further into the rural area. The city gets the buildings then diminish, and gradually you have the vast landscape opening in front of you. So in order to see, or let us say absorb, or to savor the effects of such a painting, a viewer has to walk, both from left to right, or from right to left, depending upon where you want to go, what you want to see. You have to stop on the way, have a closer view of something, go back and see a larger view. But since it cannot be completed in one single optical view, you have to keep on walking. So in a way, the painting also opens in time, as I was saying. Next, please. But it's difficult to put it in practice. When actually you want to paint something, how would you paint? How would you paint, let us say, something which you had experienced in your younger days, perhaps even in childhood? But you have a memory. And what do you do with a memory? You can't photograph a memory. You can only unravel the memory one by one. So in the painting like this, as you can see, there is a street. And in the middle of the street, there is a green building, which is a mosque. And there are people praying inside the mosque or preparing themselves for the prayer outside the mosque. But just outside the mosque, you have these women selling fish. As you go upward, there is also a man with a donkey. As you go still upward, beyond the red roofs, you have something is happening. Perhaps a story is taking place. There are two winged creatures who have carried somebody, and there is a shadow of that person who is being lifted. And I remember in my childhood, people used to say that often the farishtas or the angels would appear. But the angels may appear, but they are different from human beings because they never cast shadows. So the winged creatures don't cast shadow here, but a living figure does. But then as you come down through the mosque, going through its inside and outside, you walk in or walk out, there are these houses of the street in which in each of them, a story is being enacted. You have people going in and out. You have some boys who are playing cards. You have a man with a woman. You have a man thrashing a woman. All kinds of stories, violent stories, pleasant stories, other stories. So in a sense, the street becomes a speaking street. Next, please. But then if you want to go outside the street and you want to bring in more areas, let us say larger area, perhaps vaster area, what do you do? Here you have right in front two women. One is doing her hair, the other is half nude, is seated on the bed. But as you come down, you have the street opening in front of you, right up to the bottom. And as you move from the bottom upward on the left, you have the vast landscape opening in front of you, and a train is running through it. You have already seen the street in which there are people, and each one is carrying a story. You go upward and the big champa tree with large leaves opens out, and you have multiple stories. So it is about wandering and waiting. Next, please. Can you go next, please? This is another, but it is different. Again, there are stories, but in this case, there are personal stories because I portray myself in the middle of it with pieces of paper flying above. On the left, as you can see, there are houses and a bridge. On the right, you have a woman shooing away a monkey and a building like the house that we used to live in. It was called Residency Bungalow in Baroda. And a little boy is playing football with my son, younger son. As you come down on the right, you have a building, many buildings, but buildings are like an institution, and you have rooms, you have a stairway. If you can make up right on the bottom, there is a statue of a thinker by Rodin. And if you were to go a little further, if you could watch it, somebody is showing slides. In a sense, it was the institution where I taught for many years, called Faculty of Fine Arts. But it's not a kind of a optical representation. It's a representation, as I say, you make through your mind's eye. And in a way, memory plays a big role, but it's not that memory. Sometimes you create memory. So it is a combination of memories, like what happened on the top left, what happened on the top right. On the left, at the bottom, you see a tree with multiple heads. And there is also a story connected with it, because all heads are heads of my friends and my teachers. So it is a kind of a tree which tells stories. Tree which has got people. So in a way, what is known as speaking tree, and there is a flying figure there. Next. No, go back. Go back. Huh. But if you want to paint a city, the city as a whole, how do you paint it? What is the way by which you would perhaps grasp the essence of the city? There are these three large people. This is a large painting, about 10 foot wide and 7 foot high. So you can imagine each figure is about 5 foot, 4.5 to 5 foot. And if you stand at a distance of about 6 to 7 feet away, you can identify with them, because your size and the size of the figure would perhaps, you know, in some way, they begin to relate to each other. Now, if you were to see, these three men have gathered round over a matchstick, because somebody wants to light a bidi or a cigarette, and they gather together. They are strangers, but the city brings them together because a matchstick brings them together. As you go over, there are these women of the night. As you move on the left, there is a riot raging. Somebody has denuded a man to see whether he is circumcised or not. A man is thrown down and he falls into the street on the left. Many are running away. And at the sort of kind of a bending houses go down, you see a woman who is selling vegetables. So literally, you're beginning with the three men, went up, and you went on the left, then left again, down, and you made almost a kind of a circular journey. So you went into the city observing the variety of events that are taking place, and then finally focusing right in the middle. But a man on some kind of a scaffolding is seated painting the eyeball of a cinema actress, in this case, Rekha, in a film called Silsila, which is being screened right in front of you on a green screen. And there are other foggers. So this city for sale, at one level, portrays kind of a disparity. That those who are up there, you know, right in the middle of a riot, and those who are in the street here, or those who are sitting in the cinema hall, are as though in their different worlds. There are all kinds of events which take place simultaneously, sometimes connected, sometimes totally disconnected. Often one part of the city is raging with riots. On the other part of the city, people are living their own life peacefully, as though nothing is happened to them. Next, please. Next. To come across maps, as you saw the Nathdwara map, there is another. This is a very large map in the City Palace Museum in Jaipur, which portrays the city of Dwarka. Dwarka, which is situated on the sea. Actually, you can't see, but even the Dwarka, which is believed to be under the sea, part of it under the sea, is also shown in the map. So you have this kind of a map of a pilgrimage site. Next. And if I were to make a painting of a pilgrimage site, like for instance, Ayodhya. Ayodhya is a city fraught with contradictions. At one level, there are people of all faiths living there in the city. At other level, it has also become a hotbed of intrigue and violence. As you can see in the middle, there are four images of the demolition of the Babri Mosque. But if you see all the houses around, you have all kinds of buildings of different belief systems. And in the middle, you have the image of Ram chasing a miraculous, perhaps a Mayavi or illusive deer from the Ramayana. I wanted to bring the two together with the demolition. Next, please. Well, it came upon me at one stage to make a mural. And I had always wanted to make a mural in a public space. And it was kind of an opportunity that came my way. and it is a political venue. So like the effects of good and bad governments that you saw before, I saw an opportunity to paint the entire region or to bring in as much of the country as possible. This is about 21 foot high and about, I think, 18 or so. I mean, it says there is a measurement given at the bottom. And it was made in 13 parts, painted on canvas, mounted. And then we had a structure made for it, and then we mounted. Then there was a doorway through which all the, this is the building of the Madhya Pradesh legislature. That means the Vidhan Sabha or Vidhan Bhavan. Now there are two houses, the old, the lower house and the upper house. And this is the upper house, that is the Vidhan Parishad. And this is the entrance of Vidhan Parishad. So what to do with a place like Madhya Pradesh? I sent my assistants to go around the region to collect photographs of places, people, all kinds of things. We read stories about both Madhya Pradesh and Adhari. Madhya Pradesh also, Ujjain is in Madhya Pradesh, and you have Kalidas, Meghadutam based there. So there are these flying figures as the Yakshas. But there is also image of a temple, a Mahakala temple in Ujjain, or Tajul Mosque in Bhopal. There are other people and places. There is a storyteller on the right side, not exactly at the bottom, but little above, who is telling stories to animals and birds. That comes from Katha Sarit Sagar. I placed the legislators, the Vidhayak, on the left and on the right. As you can see, they are arguing with each other. And in between them, there are images of, as you can make out, the Narmada Dam. As you can see, that where Bhopal gas tragedy took place, and various other issues, which are, in a way, political issues. Next, please. And here is the doorway through which the legislators are supposed to pass. So we got our own doorway made, and I got some images to embed within them. But what was interesting was the story that was to be told about this political space. As you can see, there is a chair, a kind of a seat of power, and you have these flying figures around. It comes from Sihasan Battishi. In the Sihasan Battishi, as the King Bhoj ascends the throne of King Vikrama before him, there are these dolls around the throne which come out one by one and tells him a story, saying that the moral of the story was that you got to deserve to be sitting on that throne. So here is a kind of invocation of Sihasan Battishi with a message to the legislators. Next, please. Then I wanted to paint the city. What a different kind of city. How do I paint the city? Not like City for Sale, which I had already done. So with my associates, some of them you can see here, and I got together and looked at Google Earth, and we saw the city of Baroda. city of Baroda literally unfolded on the computer. And we got prints made out of them, very high resolution print. And we thought we will paint this city. But we did not want to go by the satellite view of the city. We wanted to have a living city. So all we used was the basic structure of the city. That means all the main streets. Not every lane, but main streets, the arteries of the city. And we drew them. And around those arteries, we built houses. We made drawings of people, all kinds of people who work there, especially the people who are daily wagers, somebody who repairs your bicycle, somebody, you know, who does some your mochi, or somebody who mends your shoe, etc., etc. And then I wanted to bring it down. So there are two aspects of the city at the top, on the right, as you can see, is the, can we go to the next? Here is the whole. The top is the old city, where there are, as you can see, number of stories taking place. I cannot possibly tell you. But at the bottom, there is the new Baroda city. And that I have done partially with relief, with paper mache relief. And there are these figures as the ghosts of those who have lost their habitats, have come back to retrieve them. So this is a city called City of Memory, Dreams, Desire, Statues, and Ghosts. And also there is Return of Yuan Sang. Why Yuan Sang? Yuan Sang was a Chinese pilgrim who came to India way back in history to take back the Buddhist scriptures. Interestingly, in the archaeological department of the University of Baroda, they have the ashes of Lord Buddha recovered from the site of one of the stupas in Gujarat. So there is reason for Yuan Sang to come to Baroda. Next. And you have this whole city on top laid out in front of you. It's in about 6 panels. It's 24 foot wide and it's about 6 foot high. And it has everything, all kinds of things are there in images. I need not go into details of this. We don't have the time. Next. But if I want to bring in the city of Ahmedabad, what do I do? The city older than Baroda, perhaps. So here is the, again, Google Earth view of the central part, the old city of Ahmedabad. And we found a kind of an idiom by which we could construct houses. It's a kind of a device which we developed on the way. And we cut out all kinds of areas, both outside that central part, which is, in a way, you know, that area looks a bit like heart. It's like a throbbing heart. But the throbbing heart has riots taking place. Throbbing heart has its lanes and by lanes. Throbbing hearts have people moving about. Throbbing hearts have all kinds of monuments related to history, all kinds of monuments of our own time, including monuments related to independence. Next. And that means Gandhiji. So the moment of Satyagraha took place at the bottom, as you can see some of the buildings, it shows even the place where Gandhiji lived. But it shows 4 or 5 objects or pieces of possessions that he had, like his spectacles, like his little watch, like his chappals, and like a thali with a bowl. This man, what Winston Churchill calls naked fakir, he was actually a real fakir. He had no possession. He only left behind this and independence for his country. So this is the city Gandhi left behind. This is also a large painting, about 10 feet wide and about 7 foot high. Next. But then I came across, and you might smile at me, this is the map of the world. Can we paint the whole world? How do we, if we ever even have an ambition to paint the world? So I was looking for some source. I came across this little picture postcard in the British Library bookshop, which said it is Ebstoff Mapa Mundi. Mapa Mundi means map of the world. Ebstoff is the name of the place. And that map was made in 13th century Europe, which had Jerusalem at the center, which has various other places, including Helena Haven. And also the image of Christ at the top, with hands of Christ on both sides and the feet of Christ at the right at the bottom. And you can see that the world is made of the body of Christ. I was fascinated by this anthropomorphic image of the world. And I thought I must use it. How do I do it? Anyway, with my WizKid friends, young friends who know computer better than me, we enlarged it. And I began to make my own Mapa Mundi, that means maps of the world. Next. That in this particular one, as you can see, there are four images. There is an old woman with a young man on leash. It is actually Majnu. Majnu, who was in search of his beloved Layla, who wandered around the world looking for her everywhere. And on the right is poet Kabir. As you can see that he was a weaver, he sat on his loom, and in a way he is weaving the world. At the bottom left is Mary Magdalene from the painting of Giotto, an Italian Renaissance painter, who rushes to touch the body of Christ, who had resurrected, who had come out of the grave. And Christ says, "Don't touch me." And on the right is an elderly man dancing in abandon. In the middle, inside, you will see Ram chasing the magical deer. You can see Saint Francis talking to birds. And you can see that I have changed the map. The map has got many areas which are perhaps erased. There are many areas which are recreated. So you can erase borders. You can make a world free of border. So in a sense, this Mapa Mundi is now populated with images, images of history, images of our mythology, images from India, from rest of the world. And I continued to make this thing. And I made about 10, a set of 10, but then I made many more. Next, please. This is the second example. And in here again, Majnu is looking for his Layla. Kabir is still weaving the yarn. Magdalene is still looking for her Christ. But then Majnu and the old woman appear at number of places. If you can make out right at the top, in the circle on the right of Kabir, image of Kabir, there is the map of Dwarka which you saw earlier. So Majnu and old woman have reached Dwarka. Majnu and old woman have appeared right in the middle of it, but there is no Jerusalem. The image of Christ, the head of Christ has disappeared. The world has become free of this kind of a one image, one icon. And it has become an image of multiple or people, ordinary people going around the world across borders. Next, please. But then still the world remains like a fortress, as this one is, surrounded by all kinds of clouds in which you see both demons and angels. And world still goes on with St. Francis and various other things. But in the on the outer border, outside the clouds, there are those two dervishes who are dancing away. And you have the world, which now assume perhaps a different shape and a meaning. Next. And world is not easy to cast together. You get images from all over the world. You get landscapes, you get paintings, you get photographs. You still have legs of Christ or feet of Christ, but you have many more things populating this world which is a difficult world, world full of violence, world that you create in our time in the 20th and the 21st century. And I recall famous thinker John Berger, who dubbed the 20th century as the century of pain. It was a century of violence. But at the same time, the world continues. And as you can see, that the stories continue too. Next. Then I thought how to tell stories in a way different than what I have said earlier. I thought I'll make a book. It will be a book of journeys. But I would make it a continuous book, but not like a scroll, as you saw in the very first slide. But like a concertina, like an accordion format, where all the pages are connected. So there are almost 50 odd images. I kept on painting it for almost 10 years. Whenever there was time, I painted something. When something happened, I painted that. So when something else happened, I again painted that. And I made this book of journeys. This book of journeys, in a way, also allows you to look at pages, both one by one, at the same time. You can combine, let's say, page number 3 and 4 with page number 31 and 32. So you can open all kinds of pages and you can devise your own stories with them. It is for the viewer to make his own stories from the images there are. So this was a kind of a book of, what you call, book of journeys. So journeys in that sense is not like the journey of the monk, as you saw right in the beginning. Here is a journey which each viewer, and it is a book, so it is meant for one person. And you open page after page, and you have multiple events unfolding in front of your eyes. Next, please. And I have 2 pages of it, which I want to show you. It begins with the first page of a clock tower, something like what I saw in my childhood, or some houses and trees and kind of an open landscape. Next. And it ends with all kinds of bands. These bands are like zones through which all kinds of images, cloud-like images, which are moving, something like Meghdoot from one zone to the other. And at the bottom, there is a tiny image of poet Kabir singing. Next, please. But then I thought that if I were to make a three-dimensional book, what do I do? I had seen, as you can see on the top left, what is called a cover. It's a kind of a portable shrine which performers carry on their body, and they open doors on both sides and tell stories of gods and goddesses. I found it fascinating, but I don't have to make a cover which I would carry on my body. In fact, I wanted to extend the idea of the cover. So I opened it in all four sides. So the stories are on each, shall we say, a page or whatever it is, part of it, where here is some saint leading. There is an image of Dwarka, which you have already seen. And it opens out in all four directions, with the result that it's not something which you can hold in your hand. You can, however, open it by your hand, but you have to go around and see it from all sides. Next, please. This is like, let's say, I come back to the story of Dwarka, as you have already seen the image. And here you have Majnu actually taking a shelter outside Dwarka. And you have a kind of a image from an Islamic mythology, a saint who leads you when you are lost, shows you the way. And then there are boats, the boats to sail from land to land, sometime from ocean to ocean. Next, please. If you can see it from top, as you can make out. Now there is also on the right a scene of the holy shrine of Kaaba. On the left, you have all kinds of memorial stones, and you have the ships plying. And then on other side, you have all various stories taking place. Next. But then it closes up. It becomes like a box. It's like a little chamber. In a way, it is like architecture. But this architecture is an architecture made of images. It opens out in multiple directions. And with your mind's eye, you look at the stories unfolding on the left, on the right, the back, in front, the top, at the bottom, everywhere. But this was a small cover. Cover means it is a portable shrine, about 15 inches. But when it opens out, it comes to about four feet or so. But then I thought that if I were to make a cover which you could enter into, what would happen? Next, please. And here was a cover which was 7 foot high. And the images from my paintings, images of Dwarka, as you can make out, images of a painting of mine called Returning Home. And here is that cover, which opens out on all directions, which is again 24 foot wide. Can you go to next, please? that there are these Mapamundis, as you can see right in the middle of it. As you can see on the left side, there is a whole city. On the right, there is another city. Next. And you have this city. In fact, this is related to poet Kabir, who is seated right in the middle of it, who finds himself alone in a large fortified city. If you were to read Kabir, you might come across poetry, which may perhaps take you to city, which is a kind of a mute city. In this case, it is a mute city. But then the city, next please. As the cupboard opens on both sides, you have characters from multiple traditions, multiple belief systems, what you call religions, from India, from West, from Christianity, from Islam, from Hinduism, from Buddhism, etc. And they are all seated against each other, as you can see from the left and from the right, in a dialogue of sort. It's called Sangat. That means meeting, coming together face to face. And mind you, these images are life size. So you can relate to them because they are almost like you. They come from some odd painting that I had seen where the image was about 3 feet. Here it is about 4 to 5 feet if the figure is a standing figure. And you can see details of it in the next two slides. Next. So these are people, sadhus, sufis, saints, from multiple traditions on one side. And they are on doors, as you can make out, but it's in two parts. So they are on those standing doors, which are connected, hinged together, and they are open now. Next. And these ones are on the right. These are the seekers and the skeptics. They are all together having, listening or not listening to. They are all together in some kind of a sangat of sort. Next. The only person who stands alone is Gandhi. This is when he had returned from South Africa, and Abhinendranath Tagore made a painting of three, Rabindranath Tagore, Father Andrews, and Gandhiji, when he wore a white cap and he did not have an unstitched cloth. But that was Gandhi when he dreamt of a new India, dreamt of an independent India. And I found it an image which was perhaps indicative of multiple meanings. Next. As you walk inside the cover, that is the big cover, it is called cover home, you have a speaking tree, what you saw in one of my paintings. But this is a chinar tree reconstructed digitally with all kinds of images within them, including scenes of riots, including scenes people singing and dancing, including the image of Bamiyan Buddha, which was blown up by the Taliban, including two women from Fra Angelico's painting. And it is all constructed together to form a tree, which is also, in a way, a kind of a little kind of blueprint of, let us say, habitat or living. Next, please. Right in front of that image is this image called Ark. In the Ark, there is this golden boat. On one side is Gandhi, on the other side is Kabir. Right in the middle, there are all those images which you have seen life-size. are all in small format are gathered together. On top, you can see some kind of a city or a township floating. Actually, it is the town in which I was born, a place called Surendranagar. So I put it together. Next, please. So it was like this, as you can see, the ark is on the left, ark is on the right, the speaking tree is on the left, and on top, we construed a kind of a sky, sort of sky, visitors of the sky. And that, to look at it, you have to turn around from all sides to see them, see the imagery. Next, please. So you have all these images of visitors. There are angels, there are demons, and there are walls on both sides of a dilapidated building. There are buildings on top and the bottom. And there are, again, the two dervishes dancing at the top and the bottom. So you have to see them from both sides so that one that appears upside down becomes straight. Next, please. And I'm ending to show you one cover I made a little later. You see, journeys are of all kinds. There are the willful journeys, the journeys the pilgrims undertake. Journeys we all make, you know, from place to place, with feet or through vehicles or, you know, whichever means of conveyance there is. But I thought there would be journeys which are not willed journeys. They are against your will, which means it is the story of migration. People moving from place to place. Even it is said that Kabir, at the end of his life, moved away from Banaras, where he had lived most of his life, to a small place called Maghar. So I thought I would bring Kabir here. There is one Kabir on the right, as you can see, which is from an 18th century Mughal painting, where he is on the Yan. You have already seen him in Mapa Mundi. But here on the left, you have Kabir painted by, and I have borrowed from the mural of Vinod Bihari Mukherjee. The mural in Hindi Bhavan, in Shantiniketan, is called The Medieval Saints of India. And in order to paint Kabir, he did not go back to the image like the one that I'm showing on the right, but he went to the places where the weavers lived. And so it is in the likeness of a weaver that he cast the image of Kabir, as you see him on the left. In the middle, there is a circle. The circle I have borrowed from the painting of a Renaissance artist called Mantegna. And then there are images surrounding it. We can see part of it one by one. This is a cover which is about 2 feet high. And it is in a wood, It is sycamore wood, which got seasoned because this cover took me 3 to 4 years because I kept on changing images from the beginning till end. Until finally, as I finished it, it is in this form that I'm showing it to you. So what you have next are the images from on the left. You can see image of Joseph, father of Christ, who is leading Madonna and child when they had to run away to Egypt. In the middle of the cover, between the three doors, in the middle, you have burning houses being torched by miscreants or rioters. Next. You have this whole image of flight into Egypt from Giotto, painted Giotto, painted here with the image of Joseph that you saw before and another figure following them and an angel guiding them. On the right hand side, you can see the refugees from Iraq. And in the middle, on the two doors, you can see two dervishes dancing. Next. Can you go back? You see, dervishes are supposed to be followers of a Sufi philosophy of Islam. And they perform this whirling dance. They go on circulating, whirling, putting one hand up, one hand down, earth and the sky, invoking both earth and the sky. And whirling, they go through a kind of a journey which turns out to be a sort of a journey of the spirit or the soul to uplift itself and find what is called sama, which is a stage of ecstasy. So I have quoted two dervishes here in that sense. Next, please. So now, flight into Egypt, the story of Madonna, mother of Christ, carrying little baby Christ on her lap and an angel leading them. Next. You have this image, as I showed you before. You have these many characters which are inside, including a peacock. But right in the middle of it, there is the story of the prophet of Islam and a painting in which he is shown, you know, flying towards the heaven. Next, please. But in the end, as the true Kabir followers say, that everything, no matter where you travel all over the world, but you have to return to the self. You have to return to inner self, inside. You have to make a journey towards your own self. That means that you have to find yourself. How do you find yourself? The Kabir Panthis usually sort of hold their hands and say that, look, hold this in your against your face and see yourself as though your hands are a mirror. So here is the mirror to see yourself. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, sir. Sir, can we stop the presentation so that we have a question answer round?
Sure. Okay. I hope I was clear. Okay, anyway, ask questions, whatever you have.
So we have the first question from Srinath Lohana. Srinath Lohana, can you unmute?
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, sir. So I wanted to ask you, among many other Sufi poets, you have seemed to gravitate towards Kabir a lot in your art and as your inspiration.
Mind you, Kabir is not a Sufi.
Oh, okay. Sorry, sir. So I wanted to ask you, what is your connection with Kabir? I mean, could you share your story or how you got connected and so inspired by Kabir?
I came to know about Kabir from my childhood, from my Hindi textbooks. And I found his dohas most moving. Some of them were lashing out at superstitions. There were all kinds, and I got attracted, and I remembered them. Many people would remember, Bada Hua to Kya Hua, जैसे पेड़ खजूर पंथी को छाया नहीं फल लागे अति दूर. What is there in being big? बड़ा हुआ तो क्या हुआ? जैसे पेड़ खजूर, as like a palm tree, पंथी को छाया नहीं, the traveler doesn't get the shadow, and फल लागे अति दूर, and its fruits are quite far. This is how he spoke. There were many, and I still remember, it may not come to me easily, but I can go on reciting Kabir. But later on, I got more interested in Kabir because I read not only his dohas, but also his, what you call, pad or bhajan. Especially when I heard them being sung by Kumar Gandharva. And that was my great inspiration. And I told myself, if Kumar Gandharva can sing Kabir, why can't I paint him? And I found images of Kabir, and I also created my images of Kabir, and I made a series of paintings. And in fact, I held an exhibition in which there were a number of images of Kabir. That was in around 1990s. And Kabir seemed to have figured in many of my paintings again and again, as though it just appears. Have I answered your question?
We have a second question from Minal. So I'll ask Minal to unmute and ask question.
Hello, sir. Thank you very much. It was a really, really amazing presentation. I enjoyed looking at your work and understanding your process. I am very young to even comment on your lifetime of work, but I would just like to ask you something that I, from what I read and understood, I realized that you were talking more about a journey throughout your presentation and your paintings and your work. And you're talking about a journey of the outside in the beginning, and then you eventually ended with the journey looking towards the inside with the mirror. So I was wondering that, did this journey unfold for you over a period of time, over your lifetime, or was it clear to you? How did you know what was the next thing to do for you?
My dear, life is full of surprises. You do not know what will happen next. As painters, we scribble, and out of the scribble, images appear. And images lead you to other images. Other images then connect, and then they perhaps create meanings. And then you go further and further. There is no set line, there is no recipe by which you make your journey. My journey is a kind of a, what did you call it? Sometimes it's a willful journey, but sometimes it's a journey as it happened. You know, you just take a road, as Robert Graves says, and then you find a road, sprouting into two. Which one to take? And you often take the one which is untrodden. So you take that road. I think all artists like to take that road. On that untrodden road, there are many surprises, sometimes quote unquote miracles. Sometimes something comes out, of nowhere. I'm not being mysterious or mystical. I'm talking about physical experience. When you draw, when you paint, when you take something which you have not done before, and then suddenly out of your scribbling, things appear. And they suggest a way. So I was trying to put it in logical format, but perhaps life is not so logical. I have taken road from street to a big city, to a big region, including a world journey. You know, the idea is to wander. Idea is to discover. Idea is to see the world, feel it, but not only with your eyes alone, as I said right in the beginning, but with your full body, both from within and without. And in another word, to use your own expression, I would say, the journey is both ways, outward as well as inward. And you continue to make these journeys continually in your life. It's not that at the end of your life you make inward journey. An inward journey can be made anytime. Kabir says, Tera sahi tujh mein jaag sake to jaag. He said that whatever you are seeking is within you. Just look for it. You know, so in that sense, seeking can be anything, you know. There may not even be a meaning. There may not be. It's not an organized religion that you are seeking. You are perhaps, you know, in a region different than charted out by others for you. You make your own region and you find a place there. And hopefully you will find that place worth being.
Thank you, sir. That was such a like a profound reply to the question. We have Rishav Vishwakarma. Rishav, can you unmute and ask the question to sir?
What is the question?
We're asking Rishav to ask it. Okay. I think Rishav can connect or something. I'm reading his question. Okay. Okay,
Rishav. Hello. Am I audible?
Yes.
Please.
Yeah. Yes. So, sir, while going through the painting Meghdoot that you made, so it contains a lot of perspective. Like, for example, the left side has, the bottom has, and at the same time, it also has flat imagery. So when you make such paintings, how do you manage to compose it with such a balance? Because when a onlooker looks at it, it's not like I'm looking only at the perspective side. It's like I see it as a coherent whole. So how do you manage to do that?
You have asked a question which is a very long answer. But let me try to give you a brief answer. It's not my purpose to make images in actual optical perspective. Although I'm not against optical perspective, please bear that in mind. I may perhaps use multiple perspectives. Something seen from top, something seen from bottom, something seen from right, something from nowhere. And how would you do it? Something which appears flat, but it is not flat. So what do? You try everything. You put all your, what you call, may I use the word space constructs? How you construct the space together, all kinds, European, Indian, no matter what. But those have to be internalized. And if you internalize, I don't know whether I have or not, but I have tried, that I use all kinds of perspectives, all types of perspectives. And I change them when painting demands it. Each painting makes its own demands. Each painting even sets out its own, what you call, quote unquote perspective in a different sense of the word. And hence you bring it all together within the four corners of the canvas. But you see, I am not satisfied with the four corners. That's why I try out, you know, like cover, which means one painting enters into another painting enters into, each cover has 34 images, my dear. And I have made about 15 covers, just imagine. So it is a world that you create, image into image into image, from image to image, and you can keep on reading. It's not like a holy book, I'm not saying, but it's like reading a book. You can read images he can move from one page. But you see, here it is like poetry. It's not like a simple story, but it can be a story as well. Like your story of Kabir, you have story of some other person, something happening, something absolutely physical, something which may be touching to your inward life. But can you tell them together? So to break out of the format of the square, to break out of the format of the rectangle, I tried out both with regard to my book of journeys, with regard to the covers that I made. I don't know where I am, but I am exploring. I'm still exploring. I think there is much more to go to. There are so many areas which I have not yet explored. Have I answered or not?
Yes, sir, totally.
Thank you, sir. We have the next question from Shruti. Shank, Shruti. Can you unmute?
Yeah, so completely frozen by the time we finished the presentation. It's so much of work, we sometimes wonder whether you actually ever paused for anything at all. There was so much work, so many things that you've experienced and told us about. So my question is that I've just written it here that, sir, did you pause in this journey? So many stories, so many characters, so full of perceptions and meanings, your own narrative, words carefully selected, not with caution, but they resound your belief. How do you travel so much within and out? Especially, I will just take one example of when you were talking about the cover, where you talk about religion, then you suddenly say belief of sorts, then you say Sangat, and then you say against each other, then you say skeptics and seekers, you say listening or not listening, and there is so much that you continuously take us to the painting, get us to thinking. And so as much as you say that it's been a journey for you in and out, I think as we were watching the presentation, I think it's been a mesmerizing experience for us, and was really wondering how would you paint with so many things occurring in your mind?
My dear, you have already answered my question in your question. You have answered it yourself. You have said so many things that they are put together. Look, I have taught for 29 years. So that is some experience of, putting your ideas together. I taught art history for 18 years. Every day I would go thinking about what I will be speaking. Today it is first lecture on Chinese art. The second would be on Indian, and the third would be on European. What would I do? How would I manage multiple worlds, so many different worlds simultaneously in a single day? But you do, you manage, you go from place to place, you travel in your mind, travel with your students, travel with, I would say, co-travelers, travel with, what is that very wonderful word, those who hum suffer in Urdu or Hindi, those who are with you, wherever you go, they are there. So you make them hum suffer. You travel with them, and along with them, through their eyes, through their questions, you get ideas. And you also get them articulated by looking at your students sometimes. And your students teach you so much that it comes out finally in a form that you'd never imagine you would speak. So in a way, teaching is one. Second is both painting, writing. I think life is full of, there are many, I think, gaps in life. But can we fill up as many gaps as possible? Now, of course, we need to sleep and we need to get up and we got to do this and do that. But at the same time, if you want to do that, can you put yourself into the very act of making? The act of making is also act of knowing. The act of knowing is also act of discovering. Act of discovering is what? Going somewhere, moving somewhere. That means there is a journey, continuous journey which goes on. And if you put yourself that kind of a, I don't know, I may be a wanderer, I may be just, I have this chakkar on my feet or in my mind that I move from this to that. And that is how I come across. These are the word that you saw is the word that I discovered. It came my way while painting. No painting is fully realized at the beginning. No musician would ever tell you how the raga is going to shape. It will take shape in the process and gradually it would emerge. Sometimes it's fun, sometimes it's great magic, sometimes it can be just labor. You know that. My friend Open Khakkar used to say, out of 10 watercolors, sometimes I have torn off 7. So you have to do that. You have to take the risk. Do your best. And if it doesn't work, just be merciless. And you have to go further. You should not stop there. Your journey, your search should not stop anywhere. I'm not saying that I'm an ideal person. I'm sorry if I'm giving that impression. It's a wrong impression. I'm like you, all ordinary human beings. We all are capable of these journeys. Why don't we undertake these journeys? Sometimes difficult journeys, not very easy journeys. The path untrodden is waiting for us all.
Thank you, sir. That was wonderful. And yes, we all are on our own journeys. But how you put that mirror at the end in the coward and compelled us to see our own reflection is something actually that is the takeaway today. Let's continue with other questions if there are any.
So, I don't understand what you're asking.
I just talked about my reflection to this presentation. There's no question here. There's observation.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, my dear. Very kind of you.
So, sir, I think I have a question. I think so. We see like when we are traveling through the paintings which you have showed like over time and over like a huge expanse of geography and everything like. You've seen that like there was a shift from a kind of a very dreamscape, spatial labyrinth sort of paintings to more realistic, human-centric, icon-centric like the Gandhi, Kabir. And we see that shift. So it was a deliberate attempt of yours to point out the unrest, violence in a society or the anti-Semitism or like it was just your reflection about or you, it was something you were trying to give a message to the society about this shift of maybe the innocence is taken away and it's more a kind of a brutal and a ruthless world probably. So that's my question.
Well, first of all, my dear Pritam, I would like to make it clear that this is not the entire story of my life. This is not the entire story of my work. This is a story I selected for you folks today, in which I tried to, as I said, rightly or wrongly, properly or in a bad way, I put variety of things in a logical manner, as I said earlier, so that you go from kind of a macro view of the world to a micro view of the world, as you said, from the large vistas to a singular. But that's not the story of my life. If this gives you that impression, I would like to correct it, that my story continues beyond Kabir. There are many more stories which took place after 1990 when I made a series of Kabir paintings. Then Kabir flickered in some of my paintings, and then there are paintings in which Kabir doesn't appear. There are many more things happening. That's one. Second thing which you said, I don't know exactly I understood your question. But you see, life is full of, you can't wish away violence. Violence is part of the life that you live day in and day out. You can't throw it out of the window. You can't say this cannot form part of my, it's part of your being. You know, all kinds of issues, all kinds of problems, all kinds of questions that arise, when you begin to confront them, you realize that you have to take them all. You cannot take one and not take the other. You have to take life as a whole. Whole means not one single kind of a round, kind of a, you know, globe, but life in its vastness, in its complexity, in its variety, in its multifariousness, in its, you know, in its depth, in its all kinds of avatars that life shows you in many different ways. A painter looks at everything. A poet looks at everything. He doesn't sit back and say, ah, mere samne film chal rahi hai. Aisa nahi hai. You are part of it. You also enter into it. You make, you know, in some kind of an intervention. And that is how, you know, I do not know, but that is how, for me, art works. I have to make an intervention. I have to bring as many things as possible. And how many things can I summon at a time? I can only summon a certain amount. But sometimes they come, like City for Sale, the whole city emerged. Figure after figure after figure, good, bad, indifferent, whatever, but you know, I drew it, I removed it, I repainted, I redrew it. And eventually, whatever that worked for me, I mean, rightly or wrongly, at that point of time, I left it. Because a painting, in actual fact, is never finished. Painting continues in another painting. There is a painting waiting in the wings, outside the border of a painting. And that is how, that's why I try to explore continuity. So Book of Journeys is a kind of a story of continuity. The Coward is a story of continuity, but also contrast, not only continuities. You can place, you can juxtapose them against each other. And finally, in the end, every work of art must make you sit back, think. I'm not using the word meditate. I'm not saying that. But makes you think. If it makes you think, the work has done its job. So every painting, every work doesn't have any solution. It is not meant to be providing solutions. It's meant to, perhaps, in a way, it can also allow you to make an inward journey, but also it's an outward journey. And that journey perhaps would allow you in your life to make choices. I'm not saying that painting is responsible in making your choices. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that the experience of a work of art, a music performance, a theater, a literature, a novel, a book of poems, a painting, whatever, that reflects upon you and makes your world more livable. You enter that world with some kind of a feeling and you begin to touch everything. Things which were not of much much importance suddenly become significant in your life. You know, if somebody like a painter, Morandi, paints just bottles all his life, he makes you understand that bottles in your life can have a meaning. And then you begin to look at bottles in a different way. A painting makes you look at life in a different way. It's not always life that makes you look at painting in a different way. Often it is art that makes life. So it's a journey from art to life. As it is physically, it is a journey from life to art, but also it is a journey from art to life. You come back replenished, you come back re-nourished so that you can look at life frontally. Hope I have answered all your questions.
Thank you, Saito. It's very profound.
Snehan?
Yes. So it was enthralling, absolutely. I think all of us were completely spellbound. And we really, really, really thank you. I think somewhere what was really wonderful was that there were no thresholds, which was wonderful. You know, your one painting seamlessly has a character of another painting and it kind of blends in. You have characters of different ages coming together. And that is what is so phenomenal, because in architecture, we have thresholds, we have boundaries, we have borders. But you seem to have completely smashed it all into this one lecture of yours, which is really, really fantastic. Thank you very much. We are really privileged to have had this opportunity to hear you. And it was extremely, extremely fabulous and engaging. Thank you so much, sir. I cannot have a question immediately because I know I will have a question and I will write to you. But I think it was wonderful to just listen to you and to realize that a two-dimensional painting actually is more than the space, and which is phenomenal. Because it has time in it, it has characters in it, it has no boundaries, and it has no thresholds. So thank you very much, sir. It was our pleasure to have you. And I hope all the students enjoyed. And as a teacher, I think I really wish I was one of your students. I can't be an artist, but maybe an art historian I could have been. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Thank you, sir. We can't say enough number of times thank you for coming and sharing your journey with us. Thank you.
Okay. Can we go out now?
We really don't want to go.
Yeah.
That's quite amazing.
Yes.
Thank you.
Recording is not made.
Yes.